know what? Switching from the Leslie Marshall song to the Mo Bella song, I'm going to talk to my incredible, indomitable producer, Mark Grimaldi, the best in the biz, as I say. I think we need to make the Mo portion a little, just as long as the Leslie portion, don't y'all think? Anyway, welcome to In the Know with Mo. It's so good to have all of you back again with me this week. Oh my God, do I have an incredible little show for you guys this week. A dear friend of mine, cannot wait to get there. But before we get to Chris Wagner, our guest this week, my moment of truth, of course, is going to go first as usual. And that is Moe-ment, moment of truth. This week's moment of truth is not political. It's not even antagonistic. It's actually heartfelt for me, but hopefully inspirational to each of you. The moment of truth this week for me is in line with our show today. And that is that dreams can actually come true. And there's no limit on when dreams can come true. Because today's show, I have on the privilege of having on, and I'll introduce him to you a little better here in a second, but the executive producer of the show that I co-created and I co-produced with him, and I'm co-starring in, of course, our show Unicorn Hunters at unicornhunters.com. And the moment of truth is never give up on your dreams, because I'll be 60 in October. This had been on my bucket list since I was 15 years old. And I had felt so blessed and grateful that so many of my dreams and so many of things I never dreamed of, my White House tenures and so many other blessings that I've received on my journey had all come true. And I had just decided ever being in a TV show or an entertainment series of any kind was now out of the question. But that's not true. So the moment of truth this week is simply this: never give up on your dreams. First, let's go back to square one. Have dreams. Have dreams. Have aspirations. Have hope. And never give up on them, because you just don't know what the universe has in store for you. Great segue. The co-executive producer of Unicorn Hunters, the next greatest show in the world. I'm feeling optimistic. Mr. Chris Wagner is my guest. He has very quickly become family and a brother to me. Younger brother, Chris. I will say younger brother, just for your sake.
Thanks.
But Chris is the president and the CEO of White Label Productions here in Hollywood. He has been in the production business at the highest levels. We're going to talk through all of that with him in this next hour. But he is in the creme de la creme of production companies and producers out here in Hollywood. His shows are global. His work is across all genres, from music concert, music venue production, to music video production, to television and reality shows and everything in between. We're going to get into all of that. Chris, welcome to In the Know with Mo. So great to have
you. What's up, Mo? Thank you for having me. I'm so excited.
We have Hollywood in the house. Hollywood in the house. And that's a first for this show, by the way. You're the first Hollywood type on the show. And I just couldn't have picked a better Hollywood type, because you are not the epitome of that Hollywood kind of stereotype. And we're going to talk all about that. But we do something really special, I think, here in the Know With Mo, only because I'm obsessed with this. And that is the humanization of my guests. Because I have a theory in life, you and I've spent some time together, I think you know that I practice what I preach, and that is that we go back to the beginning. We start with your childhood, because I like to show our listeners and our viewers what your life experiences have been, right? How did you become this legendary, successful producer? It doesn't just happen. So I go back to the beginning. So let's go back to the beginning. Where I know where you grew up, but our audience doesn't know. So let's start there. Where did you grow up? And describe for us what that upbringing was like.
Yeah, I grew up in a small coastal town just south of LAX called Manhattan Beach in California. And, you know, Manhattan Beach then, compared to now, was a very mellow beach town where a lot of pilots and stewardesses lived. My dad happened to be a stockbroker, and I was super fortunate, grew up right off the Strand, had had a good childhood. You know, I went to a private French school for my youth, and then a Catholic school. It was fascinating. I learned everything.
And then Catholic school.
And then a Catholic school for my junior high school.
Okay, let's talk about that for a second. That means you had the greatest dichotomy. Can you imagine? The topless beaches of France versus the nuns with the ruler slapping your hands.
You just make me smile, Mo. I was fortunate to not have any nun slapping. It's funny, one of my teachers was an ex-nun, and you could tell she was horrific for being a 12-year-old boy. It was great. I was really lucky. I went to an all-boys Catholic high school here in Los Angeles as well, the oldest high school in Los Angeles, called Loyola High School.
My God, I didn't know that, Chris. See, this is why I do this. Because even people I think that are close friends of mine, every week I'm like, I didn't know that about you. See, I didn't know that. Loyola's a very famous high school here in LA.
It is, yeah. I'll argue that it's the best high school, certainly the best experience. Makes you a man, a gentleman. Honestly, back then, I'm not tall. Fortunately, the rest of the world wasn't tall either, so I got really good at volleyball growing up here playing on the beach.
Yeah.
And got recruited by schools all around the country for volleyball, funny enough.
Really?
Yeah.
You were that good.
I was like 5 inches taller and 100 pounds less, so I could jump. yeah. And honestly, I
can relate to the 100 pounds less, but the 5 inches taller, I don't know what I can't go there.
No, I kid. And so ended up going to UC Santa Barbara. And honestly, quickly referencing childhood, I had a very interesting relationship with my father. I won't go super deep into that, but like definitely always a need and will to please him, look for his acceptance or his praise. So Santa Barbara was the school that was his dream school. So, right.
So you chose it because of just a manifestation of that.
Yeah, I believe so. And like to play volleyball at like one of the biggest schools in the country for volleyball.
Yeah.
I knew like I'd get a sign off, but then, I think like all of us, when I was a sophomore in college, and I never really knew myself, I think I just started learning myself at age 40. I quit volleyball. He was to become president of my fraternity. I was a Sigma Chi at UCSB.
And well, that explains a lot about you now.
It really does.
Yeah, president of your fraternity. That explains a lot.
It does. A lot. You can figure me out pretty quickly.
And okay, like, to our audience, bro. Just bro comes to mind. but you know what? True. I want to go back to something, Chris, because one of the things that when I do this on the show and we talk about somebody's upbringing, I like people to know why I'm going there, because we can talk right now about so what you've shared so far, and there's so many lessons for all of us, right? Yeah. One, you realized in your childhood, okay, I'm good at volleyball. And so to me, I interpret that as a good lesson for all of us, which is learn what your gifts are, right? Learn what your talents are. We don't have to have the same gifts and talents as everybody else, right?
Right.
So you figured out that's my thing, right? And so then you pursued it, not only because you probably enjoyed the hell out of it, but you happen to be naturally good at it.
Yeah, I mean, look, I could have very much let the world judge and everybody's taller than me and not do it. But it was just like my passion, possible escape, acceptance from my father. And then I got recruited. They were number 3 in the nation at that time, which was huge.
Wow.
Yeah. So I got really fortunate.
Okay. Well, that is amazing. And there's so many other things you're saying that I would love to expound on. We're about half a minute from our first break. Clearly to the audience, you know how this goes every week. You can see already we're opening up a wonderful window into the soul of a wonderful man. You're going to get to know Chris Wagner better and better every segment. And yes, in the last couple of segments, we're going to be talking a lot about Hollywood, our show that we did together. and the future of the show. But there's so much more to learn about Chris between now and then. So stay with us. Don't go anywhere. Grab a coffee. We'll be right back to In the Know with Mo.
I want to get back to seeing my grandbabies every Sunday and smothering them with big hugs and kisses.
I want to get back to football games with my boys.
I want to get back to feeling and touching, connecting with the people around me.
I want to get back to family dinners and my grandma's mac and cheese.
I want to get back to real grocery shopping, taking my time, walking down every aisle, smelling the tomatoes and melons, having a free sample or two or three.
COVID-19 has changed how we live and how we feel. But now there are vaccines. And they are the first step that let us get back to feeling optimistic about the days ahead of us. It's okay to have questions.
Is it safe?
Should I get it?
Should I wait?
Now, get the facts. Learn more at getvaccineanswers.org so you can make an informed decision when vaccines are available to you. Brought to you by the Ad Council.
Hey sis, missed you this morning. Kim told me you weren't feeling well, so I'm just doing a self-care check.
Oh, thank you, friend.
How you doing?
Girl, listen, my energy was so low because I didn't eat breakfast when I got up, so I had to miss virtual yoga with y'all.
Trust me, I understand.
But I'm doing much better now that I've eaten, so I'm back on track.
Great. In that case, let's get some steps in tonight. I'll come over and we can walk around the lake.
Sounds good. Appreciate you being in my business, too. Now, let me get in yours. Did you check your blood pressure today?
I did that and my squats, okay?
Okay.
High blood pressure is not going to be my friend if I can help it. See you at 6?
Let's get it. See you then.
Now more than ever, it's important that we protect our hearts and the hearts of those we love. Check in on one another and be a part of a healthy blood pressure movement. Rally your squad to take the online pledge at releasethepressure.org. Brought to you by the Release the Pressure Coalition and the Ad Council.
I'm Rick Smith, and this is Labor History in 2. On this day in labor history, the year was 1975. That was the day workers at Tolteca Foods in Richmond, California, went out on strike. Many were undocumented Mexican women who helped organize the plant in 1969. In his book, The Revolutionary Imaginations of Greater Mexico, historian Alan Aledo Gomez states that the women had grown increasingly frustrated with the lack of union response regarding speed-ups, immigration raids, discretionary firings, substandard wages and unsafe working conditions, and began to look elsewhere for support. They reached out to the organization CASA, which provided legal and social services for undocumented immigrants. The women decided to strike without authorization from the Contra Costa Labor Council. They packed the council's emergency meeting, where they put their scarred bodies on display to attest to the dangerous and abusive working conditions and poor wages. Just as the council sanctioned the strike, workers learned the company started removing machinery from the factory. They packed the picket lines to stop the trucks from taking out the equipment. The first driver stopped. The second plowed through several women. The strike committee won an injunction to prevent the removal of equipment, and after 3 weeks, workers won their demands. Gomez argues the strike was important for several reasons. It demonstrated that a large female and undocumented workforce could organize and win a strike against a transnational company at a moment when unions were increasingly under attack. They built a rank-and-file independence that built support for their demands from their union leaders and the broader community. The women workers at Tolteca fought for bread and butter issues. They also worked to reshape their union to take on broader issues of social justice that included immigration rights and women's rights. Labor History in 2 brought to you by the Illinois Labor History Society and The Rick Smith Show.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to In the Know with Mo. It's so good to have all of you back with me this week. My guest is my brother, my friend, my co-executive producer of our show that is going to rock the world, Unicorn Hunters. Shameless plug, unicornhunters.com. First episode is up. Please go watch it. Please go watch it. Chris and I worked our butts off to provide the world with this new series, and we hope that you partake. We wanted to share that with you. We were talking about Chris Wagner's upbringing in Manhattan Beach, California, and how you go from a sleepy coastal town and a Catholic high school and a French pre-prep school to becoming one of the top premier executive production companies and executive producers in Hollywood. So let's go there. Let's start. Now you go to UC Santa Barbara. I'm assuming you're on a volleyball scholarship. Well, you made us think you were on one, right? Because like number three volleyball school in America, and you get recruited, which, by the way, I'm so proud of you. I think that's amazing.
Thank you.
So you finish UC Santa Barbara. What was your degree in? Because there are young people that are going to watch this, native, and that are innovative, and probably have that same dream and bug that I had in my youth of how do you become a producer?
It's so funny. My parents both grew up here in Los Angeles around celebrities. So my mom always told me, they were just so unimpressed by it. So my mom always told me, she's like, celebrities are just like us. They put on their pants one leg at a time. And so even in high school, and I went to high school with some of the biggest families in Los Angeles, they would go out on Sunset, and I just never was drawn to it. I think for that, those aforementioned reasons. I was a major in political science and international relations and a minor in French. And my grandpa, who's my idol, I wanted to be a lawyer like him or go into politics, funny enough. Mm-hmm. And, you know, back to kind of the path of getting to know myself, one summer I was like, fuck it. Oh, sorry.
It's okay.
I'm going to be a
fire truck it.
Yeah, fire truck it, because I was going to be a fireman and live in Santa Barbara. And so I called my dad, ready to go, like felt strong. And my neighbor, who I grew up next to, he was a big Fox executive. Mm-hmm. He created a show called Teen Choice Awards and executive produced Billboard Music Awards. His name's Bob Bain. I called my dad. He's out on his balcony. Bob was out on his, and I was 19 or 20. And my dad's like, oh, really? And said, Bob wants to talk to you. He thinks you should come work for him for the summer to be a PA, which I had no idea what a PA
was. Yeah, what is a PA? Yeah.
Yeah, and as a kid who grew up next to the executive producer, I'm like, I've got an easy street. So I did that. 1999, I did Teen Choice Awards as a PA. I met my then mentor.
And just for our audience, by the way, PA means production assistant.
Sorry.
This context. No, that's okay. No, that's part of what I like to do on our show. We want to enlighten people into new sectors, new industries. So, because it also could mean physician's assistant in the medical context. So we want to say it's a production assistant. No.
Yeah, and what's interesting about being a production assistant is, unlike any job entry-level position, there is no training. It's like you're
thrown into the fire.
You're thrown into the fire and you make it or you don't.
Yeah.
Which is a lot of this business, really. So I did it. I asked if I had to wear suits, which, as you know, on set, it's as casual as it gets in our business. Yeah. And I loved it. My dad wanted me to take over his business. Again, it was a stock brokerage firm, wear a suit every day. I knew what my dad's mood was based on how the market was doing. And I was just so turned off by it.
Yeah.
And my neighbor, who cruised in shorts and a Hawaiian shirt every day to work, I was like, this looks fun. I'm meeting, you know, everybody is on an equal playing field, be it you went to Harvard or you didn't finish it. Everybody had rose to the top, and it just felt like a business of opportunity. And I love people, and you have to very, very much be a people person in this business. So I was like, this just seems like the right fit. So it's the next steps are interesting. I flew myself out to Vegas to do the Billboard Music Awards. I drove myself to San Diego to do L'Oreal's, like when Britney, Christina, and NSYNC were going. And I graduated college. I got a job right out of college as a production coordinator, which never happens, on the biggest game show then called Weakest Link. And my mentor, I finished that up. My mentor was like, hey, I'm going to do a new music show. something from Britain. They're looking for the next Britney Spears. I think they're going to call it like American Idol Search for a Superstar. And honestly, that was, it was right time, right place.
But okay, let's time out right there because
time out.
Well, there are just so many powerful lessons in there. And I love to do that here at In the Know with Mo, because to me, learning from someone else's story is so powerful to me. And you and I talked about this over dinner the other night, right?
Yeah.
So it's, I just want to stop right there for a second, pause, and let's go over that, because there are a couple of lessons I think we need to highlight. One is one of my favorite personal lessons that now you just affirmed, right? And that you experienced yourself, which is on that day that your dad was on the balcony with Bob Bain at the next balcony, had you not had an open mind, had you said, I have tunnel vision, I am going to be a veterinarian, come hell or high water, I don't care what anybody says, I don't care what anybody throws in front of me, I don't care what the universe puts on my path, I'm not looking, you would not be where you are today.
Correct. 100%.
And so one of the lessons that I appreciate you, that I'm getting from that I want to share real quickly is, please, we should all remain open-minded, open-hearted. Our soul should be open and listening and watching to what the universe or God or Buddha or Allah or whatever you believe in or whoever you believe in, whatever is put on your path. Right, Chris? Because had you not done that,
100%.
Imagine how different your journey would be.
I still do it to this day. Like, just kind of big believer that everything happens for a reason.
Me too. And I think a lot of it is because you and I are we're very kindred spirits. We have a very shared value system, shared vision of life. And I think a lot of it is this, that we both believe in that, which is pay attention, but also be ready. Right.
Right.
Ready, so you can adjust to what that is, right? And or adopt what that is, or inject that into your life, right? And so a lot of it's being ready and being open to it, right? Don't you think?
Oh yeah, you have to be, and you just have to realize people, places, shows in this case come into your life for a reason.
Well, I mean, what happens if that day you had not had that open spirit and they said American Idol, superstar, whatever, and you would have gone, oh, that sounds just horrible. I'm not doing that, right? Or that doesn't fit into my career plan. Or, my God, that's not the direction I want to go. I only want to do soap operas, right? Had you done that, your life would have been so different. So once again, every time we're like in the heart of something, we get Mark Grimaldi tells me I have 15 seconds. So we have to take our second break, but you can tell this is getting good. So you just stay with us. We'll be right back after the break with Chris Wagner from White Label Productions.
Hey, Dad, how do airplanes fly? What's in this box? Can I touch this? Where does sand come from? Is this tree good for climbing? What happens if I mix these two things together? How are babies made? What does this thing do?
Kids are curious about everything, including guns. Talking to them about gun safety in your home is a good first step, but you can do more. Always keep your guns locked, unloaded, and stored separately from ammunition. Storing your guns securely is the best way to prevent family fire, including unintentional shootings. For more information on safe gun storage and ways to keep your family safe, visit endfamilyfire.org. That's endfamilyfire.org.
What do we keep in the attic? What's this thing called? Can I ride my bike backwards?
Like I said, kids are curious. It's up to us to keep them safe. Brought to you by End Family Fire, Brady, and the Ad Council.
Right now, our country feels divided, but there's a place where people are coming together.
I gotta tell you, I was nervous to talk to someone so different than me.
Me too, but I'm glad we are.
Love Has No Labels and One Small Step are helping people with different political views, beliefs, and life experiences come together through conversation, and it feels good.
Wow, your story is so...
interesting?
Yeah.
When people actually sit down, talk, and listen to one another, they can break down boundaries and connect as human beings. At lovehasnolabels.com/onesmallstep, you can listen to amazing, life-changing conversations and find simple tools to start a conversation of your own.
I know one thing. This conversation gives me hope.
It gives me a lot of hope, too.
Take a step toward bringing our country and your community together by having the courage to start a conversation at lovehasnolabels.com/onesmallstep. A message from StoryCorps, Love Has No Labels, and the Ad Council.
We've got the Academy Awards, the Emmys, and Grammys. But what should we call the award for the most extraordinary performance by a corporate profiteer? How about the Sleazy, with winners getting a solid gold sculpture of a middle finger? There were so many worthy contenders, but one corporation exhibited uncommon callousness, so the 2021 Sleazy goes to Tyson Foods. The meatpacking giant has regularly run roughshod over workers, farmers, communities, and the environment, not to mention the millions of animals it fattens and slaughters. But the coronavirus pulled out the worst in Tyson's corporate ethic. Last April, its billionaire chair, John Tyson, ranted that health officials who were closing down several of his slaughterhouses that had become hotbeds of contagion were creating another crisis, a national meat shortage. Responding instantly, our corporate compassionate, burger-gobbling president decreed that meatpacking plants were crucial to America's national security and must be kept open at all cost. Trump's edict required workers to return to their jobs or be fired. Only, there was no meat shortage. Indeed, Tyson and other giants actually increased their meat exports to China last year. Meanwhile, COVID rampaged through Tyson's factories. In its Waterloo, Iowa facility alone, a third of the processing workers were infected and at least six died. Which brings us to the corporate play that cinched this year's sleazy for Tyson. Waterloo slaughterhouse supervisors actually knew that the back-to-work order would sicken hundreds, but not exactly how many. So, managers organized a winner-take-all betting pool on the percent of employees who would test positive. It was simply something fun, said one, kind of a morale boost. This is Jim Hightower saying the virus infected more than a third of the workers in the plant. Some fun, huh?
Have all of you this week. My guest this week is my friend, somebody I admire greatly, and we're learning so much about from Chris Wagner, the CEO of White Label Productions out here in Hollywood. Okay, so Chris, you name dropped right before the break. So now that opens up this huge Pandora's box, right? Because I'm joking, but I'm not. Because on a serious note, you have really kicked ass out here in Hollywood. 23 years in the business. From that moment that Mr. Bain on the balcony next to your dad's balcony said, why don't you come be my production assistant for the summer to today? Will you now just give us a litany of the shows that you have been a part of the production of, because they are some of the greatest shows in the history of the country?
Yeah, I've been so fortunate. I did three seasons of American Idol, which having, you know, casting from holding signs by a bar to holding casting in football stadiums. I got burnt out. So from there, I went to a show called Rockstar at Mark Burnett, which had Tommy Lee. I did both of them. First one was then did a show that Fox greenlit in December to be on the air in February called Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader?
Oh, I remember it very well.
Yeah, and right after that.
Who was the host of that? Who was that host? It was that funny guy.
Jeff Foxworthy.
Jeff Foxworthy, yeah.
Such a good human and so good at what he does. And in between seasons of Fifth Grader, Mark Burnett had sold a small show pilot, actually, called Shark Tank. So I did Tank Pilot, which became the first two episodes and obviously is ongoing and a great show.
13 years later, it's still going. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
Do you see a pattern here? And I'm going to let you keep going, but I'm just saying there's a pattern, which I want to point out to our audience. Okay. Listen to how many of your shows are still going today.
I'm so fortunate.
That's amazing.
And from there, I did, X Factor, which was Simon Cowell's competition for American Idol. Got MTV Movie Awards, Guys' Choice Awards. I produced an inauguration, Million Second Quiz, which was NBC's. It was really the first ever live game show on air. And then started my own company about 6 years ago, and have been super fortunate. Have done a little bit of every genre across every platform.
So you scripted work?
Yeah, very little.
But a lot more in the music space, right? Like that's a really, you were drawn to that.
I love music. Big live events, big concerts, things like that. That's my passion.
Give us a couple of examples of those because you know our audience is dying to hear that. Well, I mean, let's start with Rihanna's latest.
I do Rihanna's fashion show, Savage by Fenty for Amazon. The MTV Movie Awards is a great one. American Idol and X Factor I told you about, but they just hold a special place in my heart because of all the music.
Rihanna, let's talk about Rihanna. She's so well-respected. She's so loved. Very iconic figure. I'm very careful on the show not to divulge things that people told me privately or personally, but I think this one, I'm not going to go into detail, but you said something to me in a conversation we had a couple weeks ago that really stayed with me. You said Rihanna has done such an amazing job of remaining in control of her image and her brand.
Everything. It's amazing.
And I thought that was such a good lesson to share today.
She's an icon. She's such a boss. Like she still is involved in the minutia of every aspect of anything she's involved in, from the Fenty line to her show. She's got a great team around her that have known her for a long time. It's so impressive.
That trust and that comfort level, right? And that kind of cohesiveness that's necessary. Knowing kind of what she would expect, right? Probably.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think you see a lot of these celebrities with brands and companies. I can't speak for all, but a lot are hands off. And she is the opposite. As successful and busy and crazy scheduled as she is, like, it's really cool to see someone work so hard.
Isn't that wonderful? And it pays off for
her.
But I wanted to share that only because it's so important, I think, for all of us that are listening to you and learning from you, that there's a lesson there for all of us. And that is never give up that control of what might be your identity, your image, your brand, how people perceive you or how people get to know you, right? And I think if you relinquish that control, then you're in essence giving yourself up. And I think it's dangerous.
Well, she's such a visionary. And it's just so true to herself. And it's beyond impressive. It reminds, I know it's not my job to segue. That's your job, Mo. But it reminds me of like you and Alex coming to us for Unicorn Hunters.
Oh, well, we're going to talk about that. And I appreciate you saying that. I really do. And remind me to go back to that specific topic. Because I think I appreciate you saying it. But, I want to talk about that kind of purity, if you will. There's an innocence right to it, right?
Yeah.
And then the maintenance of the value, the core values. That's a great segue into a question I have on my list that I wanted to ask you. Perfect segue. So I've gotten to know you, right, the last several months. We've worked extremely closely together. I really have seen, I wasn't kidding, a little window into your soul. You're a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful human being with this amazing, amazing soul. Like you're just, there's an unconditional love in you that I've been very touched by and inspired by. And the question I have for you today, and I mean, I can't wait to meet your three children because
they're amazing.
I'm hoping that they are picking up that core value that you so deeply possess. And I can't wait to see them evolve and grow in these next years. But that has struck me about you. And the question I have for you today is, because it doesn't matter whether it's entertainment and show business, or whether it's Wall Street, or whether it's the energy industry, or the oil and gas industry, or, right, it doesn't matter. Most industries and sectors are extremely competitive. There is a level of pretentiousness in almost every one of them, right? There's a little fakiness in almost all of them. People pretend they're somebody they're not. How do you, 23 years later, remain so beautiful as in your soulful way? You never abandon your core values of compassion and care. How does one do that in a highly competitive industry, whichever one it is?
I mean, first off, thank you. That's unbelievably kind, and I have to reiterate the same about you, and I think that's why we connect so well. You know, I think it comes from my mom. You haven't met her, but you will. Like, she's the sweetest person. I remember my first boss, who I referenced as my mentor, she told me, she's like, you're not cut out for this business. You're lucky people just want to help you. And obviously, I took that as a huge insult. And like, you know, I was 23, and she was just tearing my head off. Mm-hmm. And you hear in Hollywood, I think, very much then, I got the tail end of it. Like, it was the most successful people were the yellers and the violent people and, like, you know, swinging dicks. Thank you. Just from an early day, like, again, I love people. Like, I enjoy speaking with people. I love learn, like you, I love learning about people and, like, what their path was. So at 23, I was just asking everyone questions. I was introducing myself, and I was always
a sponge, that infamous sponge.
Totally. I tell Sydney the same. Just ask everyone. Never pretend you don't know anything. And I was just always honest and fair. And like, that's something I believe in life. You have to be honest. You have to be fair. Be kind. A simple smile can change someone's day. You don't know what they're going through.
So can your words. So can our words. Look at the infamous. That lady had on you. To this day, you still remember that she told you you weren't. Words matter.
Because they're not physical, they're harder to deal with, I think, than like a punch to the face. Where you're like, that hurt, and you're over it. So, you know, it's just a recent realization after two business partners also, like, you're too nice. You're not going to succeed. And it's just like, well, fine. I'm going to be myself no matter what, because I have to be with myself at the end of the day, and I'll just go out on my own, do my own thing, and I'll either be successful or I'll go bankrupt. But
and let the cards fall where they may, right? And so what's the moral of the story as we go into our last break? Just be you and stick to your core values. Chris Wagner did it, and look where he is today. We'll be right back because we're going to talk about unicorn hunters, how I ever met Chris, why, and everything about it. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
What I know about courage, I learned from my adoptive mom. She said sometimes you just got to hold on and know we'll get through this.
Mom, we are so high up. Hold my hand.
No, you hold my hand.
Here we go.
Learn about adopting a teen from foster care. You can't imagine the reward. Visit AdoptUSKids.org to find out more.
I learned patience from my adoptive dad. All he had to say was,
"Hey, you got this. Just breathe." Hey. Hey, we're pretty good.
Yeah.
Might have to start a band.
I got it.
Learn about adopting a teen from foster care. You can't imagine the reward. Visit AdoptUSKids.org to find out more. This message is brought to you by AdoptUS Kids, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, and the Ad Council.
COVID-19 has changed how we live and how we feel. We show up differently, worship differently, and have found new ways to express our love and support to family and friends. But now there are vaccines, And they are the first step that lets us get back into the things we miss most. Like spreading the word without spreading concern. Girls tripping instead of solo sipping. Brunching instead of late night munching. And talking smack with a side of mac and cheese. It's okay to have questions about COVID-19 vaccines.
Should I get it?
Should I wait?
Is it safe?
Can I trust it?
What about pre-existing conditions?
Now get the facts. Visit getvaccineanswers.org so you can make an informed decision when COVID-19 vaccines are available to you. Brought to you by the Ad Council.
Welcome to Code of Whack, your podcast on America's broken healthcare system and how Medicare for All could help. I'm your host, Brenda Gazar. What challenges do doctors and their patients face when it comes to giving and receiving quality healthcare in America? To find out, we spoke to Dr. Nancy Naparco, a pediatric neurologist who works for Children's Hospital, Los Angeles. Welcome to Code Whack, Dr. Naparco. So what is it like as a physician dealing with different health insurance companies?
Just like they will refuse payment to a doctor for seeing a patient, they refuse to the doctor the ability to order the best medicine or treatment without a lot more work and validating it, and still you can't get it. In fact, I do a clinic on Saturday. I see about 15 patients, and I will say almost every single one of them, I spent a good part of the medical visit talking about what was rejected and trying to think up other things that might help their child. I can pick out the best treatment and even be conservative about it. Not the strongest medicine, but something that should work, or different tests, and they get rejected. Insurance just won't cover it. I totally resent medical insurance companies. I'm in the position that I think medical insurance companies have no right to exist.
Thank you, Dr. Nancy Naparco. Find more Code Whack episodes on progressivevoices.com and on the PV app. You can also subscribe to Code Whack wherever you find your podcasts. This podcast is powered by Heal California, uplifting the voices of those fighting for healthcare reform around the country. I'm Brenda Gazar.
Welcome back to In the Know. Oh, sorry, we're laughing because of the love that these guys and I share, but we were talking during the break and we were having a little fun, but a very deep conversation about how we went to break on the last thing we were saying with Chris, which was about always maintaining a sense of self and your core values and never abandoning who you are, that love, the kindness, the compassion, the empathy, that we don't have to be hateful and shrewd and mean in order to succeed, because success is what we define it as, not what other people define it for us, right? Okay, we're in our last, I hate this, the time goes so fast.
Too quick, man.
Every week we go, I need another hour. But so look, I apologize ahead of time to our audience, Chris, but I do want to spend the last segment talking about the show, what brought you and I together on the journey of life, and this wonderful project that we've gotten to work on together. So, of course, it's the show called Unicorn Hunters. I have the privilege of co-creating the show and then co-producing with Chris and some incredibly talented people. And then co-starring in it, if you could call me a co-star. I don't know that I'm worthy of that yet. But so Unicorn Hunters, unicornhunters.com, episode one is up. Everything you see there is at the hands of this man right here, Chris Wagner, and his incredible colleagues, Craig Plestes and Adam Madelon, and a whole team of incredibly brilliant people that I am forever indebted to. So, Chris, let's talk about Unicorn Hunters. So I call you guys and say, I have this idea that my colleague Alex Kananikin came up with, right? And you guys think it over and say, what? Like, we get these ideas. How many of those do you get a week?
Well, do you edit this, by the way?
No. But just tell the truth.
Well, that was going to determine my next statement. Look, there are... We get a lot of calls, I say the business in general, about very wealthy people from China, very wealthy people from Russia. And when it's time to step up and play ball, be that cut the check, they back out. And you spend so much time. So when I first heard it, I was a bit closed-minded. Didn't know.
Well, you had bad experiences. So yeah, they form our thoughts. Yeah.
And plus this called me. But I had done Shark Tank, so I was like, oh, this makes sense. So I went into it closed-minded. But what happened, it just continues to open my mind and, just trust my gut and my heart. But it's amazing. We got called in December to produce a show by February, but do a huge document explaining what that show is. And don't worry. This very wealthy Russian man, who I didn't even know the name of at that point, pay for it all, and we just dove in. Definitely like a leap of faith to an extent. Definitely a massive, massive concept that I wasn't sure how it was going to air because I didn't. I mean, I'm just now, it's hitting me. After Alex sent the email this morning, you're like, I get it. And we talk about this all the time. You see these CEOs and these powerful people, the visionaries that you can't understand, but you have to take that leap of faith. And it was a leap of faith that, I'm beyond grateful to be a part of. It's so cool to do something so visionary, so different, access not only to be viewed by so many people, but the overarching business model to democratize investing in wealth, and like we saw in GameStop, taking away the power from Wall Street and these VCs and just
giving it to the people.
Yeah, instead of
giving it to the people. And as and poor. I know that you share our underlying premise, and I think that, like you said, I think you kind of grown with the show, right? In the sense that because I've watched you since the day I met you 140 days ago, I watched you evolve in the sense that you're now like our biggest cheerleader. And you're like, because of course, just so our audience understands, the basic premise of the show is to democratize access to wealth creation. For far too long, right? Only like the top 1% of the world has been able to have access to invest in these pre-IPO emerging growth companies. And so we said that is absolutely absurd. That is unfair. And that was creating this economic injustice, if you will, this lack of equality that we all feel and sense was because of it's rooted partly in this economic lack of parity. So that's the primary premise of the show, is to open up the investment ecosystem to everyone, every corner of every village. And I know now, I've watched you, you're like, okay, we're changing the world, right?
And yeah.
To me, I wanted to ask you this about the show. Are you at the same place I am now, where I feel like you've done this for 23 years? My first experience, right, helping a little, not on the technical production, obviously, but on the creative side, and coming, helping you develop the idea and such. I'm at an interesting place, and I'm curious to see if that's where you're at, that now I see the power of storytelling the power of your industry and how it can literally change the world. Have you always felt that?
Well, I think so I got into the business because I wanted to be a music video director, because the power of music and the storytelling.
Yeah.
But it's just, it's digestible. A story is something that everyone can understand, and it's digestible versus what you just said. We're democratizing wealth for everyone. Everyone gets it, but when you watch the story of it, you understand it, you relate to it, and then it inspires you. And, just seeing again, I don't know what I'm allowed to say or not, but the numbers that Alex is sending over about 48 hours ago, you know, the show hadn't even aired and nobody had a clue, but now it's on every major news outlet, the biggest trades in Hollywood. I mean, it's what you and Alex came up with, but you're right. I have become the biggest cheerleader. Like, what can I do next to help?
Well, let's talk about that. We just agreed yesterday. We can announce it right now. We're doing season two. We're shooting 9 shows right in September. And that's a big deal in Hollywood. Am I just being self-aggrandizing?
No, it is. I mean, it's a time where studio network execs are hesitant to pull the trigger and do it so quickly. And again, applaud you and Alex for getting behind it. It's what you guys have done is beyond impressive and beyond inspiring.
Thank you, Chris. We couldn't have done it without you guys. You know that. We could never have done it without your team. But so let's talk a little bit, because I like to enlighten and educate at the same time and not just, you know, I guess, do we want everyone to watch? Please go to unicornhunters.com and watch. I agree with Chris and I that it's magical, and that the stories that we will be sharing with the world every 2 weeks as the episodes unfold. Each week is a different inspiration. It's a different motivation, a different chance to have access to invest and to engage in wealth creation. But we're down to the last couple of minutes together. So let me ask you this, because I felt that the result was powerful storytelling. And I felt that the chemistry, not just of us on set, but also with you as our production partners, magical. Is that the case in every single show you've ever worked on? Is it always that loving and magical?
No. No, it isn't. And I feel like when you do get those, sorry, Mark. When you do get those magical moments, I feel like it comes through on screen, you know, like just those shows where everyone clicks. And having seen it from December to now, it's unbelievable, the process. It's unbelievable, like all these different humans came together, not knowing each other.
That's right.
And not only clicked, but created this beautiful thing.
Well, and again, it takes the magic of the production company, White Label Productions. In this case, Chris Wagner has been our guest. He is very dear to me, very quickly. Anybody who knows me knows that when somebody loves, they're going to get Mo Vela's love. And this guy loves. He knows how to love. And Chris, I'm so deeply proud of that you have remained your beautiful self in an industry that has tugged at you in every direction to not be that way. And yet you remain a pure and beautiful soul. And to our audience, I know they're going to feel the same way about you when they watch this episode. And I can't wait for season two. Folks, go watch Unicorn Hunters at unicornhunters.com and stay with us all summer, because Chris and I will be back in your lives with a whole nother 9 shows in the fall and another 12 we're going to shoot in December. We're going to stay in your lives. So just come join the cause at Unicorn Hunters. It is a cause. It's a movement. Everyone should have access to the chance to grow their wealth. So thank you, Chris Wagner. I love you, my brother. A big hug.
Thanks,
to
Mo.
You. I look forward to spending the next many years together, creating, producing, and just loving each other. Thank you.
Love you, Mo. That was so fun.